Well, starting at the start, I guess I was born in 1952. And reflecting on that, that was 7 years after the end of World War II. Reflecting back, I'm sure that was a big part of those post-war years of how I grew up. I was born in Durham, and I eventually managed to get to university in Exeter, and then I went back to Durham to do a master's in geotechnical engineering. My first job, I got sent to Nigeria to work on a road expansion, which went through this massive waste dump in the middle of Lagos, which wasn't a particularly nice assignment, but I guess they didn't have anyone else that could go, so that's why I got the job. And I managed to stay with that company, which is called George Wimpey. I stayed with them for about 6 or 7 years, initially doing site investigations with engineering geophysics tools, and then got more into the sort of geotechnical soil drilling and all that sort of stuff, mostly for infrastructure. Times were quite different then. There weren't that many jobs around. That was in the mid-70s, I think there was yet another recession there, pretty well worldwide. So I ended up, as I say, taking a job in engineering geophysics and then getting sent to various places where nobody else would go to get a foot in the door. And then because I worked for a large company there, I was able to move from geophysical site investigations into the more geological engineering type work with the drilling and the foundation engineering. When you're working in a job like I had at Wimpey's, doing basically site investigations using various methods, they tend to be short assignments. A lot of it was overseas work, or a lot of it was out of town work, and there was lots of opportunities at that point in time, including South Africa and Hong Kong and Canada. I had a friend who left Wimpey's and gone to Toronto, who told me about, you know, boom times in Alberta with the oil sands and things. So my wife went down to the Canadian embassy and said, you know, we're interested in moving to Alberta to do engineering. And they said, no chance, forget about it. But she's not a lady to be put off lightly. So she actually got hold of the yellow pages for Alberta and photocopied the list of engineering consultants. I wrote off to pretty well all of them, and I got something like 6 or 7 job offers by return mail, including one from what was then Klohn Leonoff. And I'm not sure what it was about Klohn Leonoff that appealed to me. I mean, you couldn't get on the website and have a look at, you know, all the cool projects that people are doing and, you know, how happy everybody is with their social activities. But, you know, I did do some research and I found that Klohn was, you know, quite heavily into dam type engineering, which is the thing that was starting to appeal to me, you know, within the engineering field. So that's how I ended up with Klohn Leonoff in Calgary in 1981. But in 1981, there was an incredible oil price crash. And I think the price went from $20 or $30 a barrel to $5 or so, more or less the day I got there. So, so although Klohn had been on a big hiring spree in the late 90s, early 80s, this all hit home pretty well when I got there in Alberta. It doesn't just impact the oil sands, but it's all the government revenue and all the government projects, and Klohn was doing a lot of water dam reservoirs, which is we still do. But they were put on hold and cancelled, you know, and I was there with two little kids and a wife. But, you know, I don't remember being at all concerned at that point in time because I was developing my career. So that was just another bit of experience. And, you know, I always had the opportunity to go back to the UK to go and do a PhD while things cooled off, or or whatever. But as luck would have it, I guess Klohn got this pretty big job in Papua New Guinea. So I went off there, you know, and that was quite an interesting, challenging job. It was really out in the middle of nowhere. I mean, I think to get a fax off, you had to go to the central administrative building and book a time and then, you know, give your fax to somebody and they would send it off. So the communication was really slow. And anyway, we were out in a fly camp half the time. So I was there for about 3 or 4 months and got roundly told off by my wife when I got back for not communicating with her and the three babies. So that then turned into a long-term assignment. The family went over with me in, I think it was 1983-6 or something like that, 1986. So that's how I really got in. You know, that was my first break on a big project on dams. And yeah, that was my in that to, you know, what I really wanted to do with my career. You know, I'm a geotechnical engineer, so whether I'm working on a mining dam or a hydro dam or, you know, any other sort of geotechnical type engineering project, it's really irrelevant to me what the industry is. And it just seemed like, I guess with my, I guess, abilities and interests, that mining seemed to suit my style of work. Because the thing about mining projects is they tend to get off the ground very quickly. They're very immediate. Often, as a soil mechanics, engineering, geologist type person, the mining dam, tailings dams are mostly earthworks. That means the geotech engineer is kind of the king of the castle. And, you know, I mean, I guess curiously enough, you know, the family history in mining is quite extensive because my ancestors came over from Ireland to the north of England and they were working in lead mines then. I guess my grandfather worked in the coal mines in Durham, big coal mining industry. My father got out of it, he was a teacher, but you know, when you look back, there is a little bit of history there, which is, you know, I think sort of gave me a bit of sense of, you know, belonging maybe to that industry too. I think there's a huge benefit to Canadian engineers going overseas because A, you've got a good chance of learning something from talented individuals in those other countries, but also you are left on your own a little bit more than if you're working, you know, close to head office where everything's on the same time zone and you just pick up the phone and say, you know, what happened? What do I do now? You don't have that luxury when you're out in the middle of nowhere. And I know communication's better now, but you still very much have to make your own decisions and live by them. So I think it's definitely a two-way street. It's, you know, I guess at the start of my career, I was a little bit more biased towards Canadian engineers giving their experience and talent, you know, to mentoring local engineers. Now I think it's much more a benefit to the Canadian engineer to go overseas to get that experience without the close supervision and also to learn from you know, the local engineers and what their practice is and then bring some of those good ideas back to Canada. I think it's massive, actually. Because when I look back, you know, the first few projects I did in mining, often the tailings dam was very, very much an afterthought. I mean, it was, you know, the classic case of you'd go to a mine site and they wouldn't even know where the tailings dam was there. Somebody had to, they had to find somebody who knew where it was and take you out there. So the tailings dam was very much just the dam, and a lot of it was related to, you know, storage volume. So you'd you would design a dam, do run some slope stability analyses, sometimes just give people a hand sketch, and the thing would be built, maybe you did or didn't go back for the raises, because these things are raised pretty well every year. And that's obviously changed completely now, and a lot of it, I mean, not just because of the high-profile failures that have happened in the last 5 or 6 years, but even, well before that, the whole tailings disposal became a lot more than just the dam. It was the environmental side, there was the social side. You had to deal with not just the dam design, which obviously had to be stable, but all the water management, the deposition. And then the mining companies have gotten much more process oriented. So there's a much broader scope for engineers and scientists, and, you know, I guess tailings management is a much broader industry than it was when I first started. It was a fantastic privilege to be appointed as president and CEO, and that was in 2014. Throughout my career, I guess a lot of what I'd done has been governed by disasters. So back to 2014, but there was an incredible recession in the mining industry, especially in Australia and in the oil industry in Alberta. I think, you know, when you're offered a job like this, I think I had 3 or 4 months to think about it, you know, and all the things I was going to do. And of course, they all went out the window because, you know, of this recession. And whether it was a fluke or good judgment, the economy turned around probably in 18 months, which meant we, you know, had staff available when people wanted projects done at a reasonable rate. And we came out of that recession very quickly. We were also hiring people because we had the money and the projects to do it. So a lot of people who had been laid off by other companies, and we were able to sort of pick and choose. And of course, we got through that. And hello, here comes the COVID pandemic. So, you know, I've never even considered that. But, I never had a plan B. You know, even when things looked pretty grim in Alberta, then, you know, it was always go and find another engineering job, because there's so much opportunity. And, you know, if you're prepared to travel and move around, which my family was, I mean, you know, they liked that aspect of my job. When you even, you know, in any type of work now, that there's a lot more than just the engineering side. So I think you probably gleaned from what I said was, you know, you can have a plan, but don't expect it ever to work out, because, you know, these macro economic factors, or, you know, some weird thing in your own company or your own life is going to derail your organized career path. Don't be in too much of a hurry to get, I would say, up into management, because you need to understand your business. You know, I mean, I think, you know, all this is from a perspective of a company like Klohn, where the technical staff do the technical work. They also manage the company. They write all the proposals. They deal with the clients. And you need to get to a certain stage in that, so that you're able to, get out of the day-to-day. You know, you're not being sent anymore for a 3-month site investigation program somewhere. You're able to do the management and keep your hands in with the technical stuff, which most managers in our company do that. So don't, you know, enjoy your initial years where you're learning so much about how to do things and improving your technical skills, and at the same time maybe you know, deciding what part of the industry, and like I said, I came to the conclusion I wanted to be in dams. I had no idea how to get in there, but, you know, eventually the opportunity comes up and you have to take it.